Okay, so I guess we can get started here. Run through the first normal bit. We still have pretty much the same set of this week. We promoted the GPU table update viewer finally. So maybe we'll have solved some problems there. Other release candidates that are in various stages of production are Google BreakPad, maintenance, and the interest list viewer, Project Interesting. BreakPad and Interesting are both getting assorted repairs right now, but they should be out again shortly. Those are coming. We won't be doing any release next week. The whole week is a no change window. So we're not going to be fooling with that.
When does your no change window start for December? For Christmas holidays?
One moment, I will look.
I think it's Tuesday.
So Thanksgiving starts November 25th, and then basically the whole second half of January, December 16th through January 1st.
Okay. We've got a big release coming out on the 23rd. kidding.
So we have a couple of weeks where we can get things released at the beginning of December, and then we've got a big blackout.
I wish tomorrow.
So we can still release Project Viewer updates during the no change windows, as long as it's not, you know, something egregiously terrible. So I'm not sure whether we will be doing that or not.
Well, really, you're just looking at basically between now and January is maybe two weeks worth of releasables.
Right. That's right. But we very well may be doing Project Viewer updates during that time.
Okay.
I expect that there will be a fitted mesh update at some point pretty soon. You know, some issues have been filed.
Congrats on that, by the way.
Some of them appear to be real good issues. We're getting the repairs together, and when we've got enough of them to do a release with that have been tested, then we'll pop that. We'll do an update to that one. As much as we're getting very, very good feedback from it, there are not a lot of users trying to run it, so we're not especially worried about updating it.
Interesting thing that Worley pointed out that all Firestorm seems to need to do, and probably the other viewers as well, I guess, is to include two XML files. Is that right?
Ideally, that's true. But it turns out to be not quite completely true. It turned out that there were some code bugs that the new skeleton and waiting information exposed. So there are actually some changes that will be.
So there will be some code. Bummer.
There is some code. Yes.
Any kind of I know it's impossible to say, but like a month, 2 months.
Well, certainly not until after New Year's before we put it in a release candidate. I don't think.
Okay. because obviously we're going to, I mean, all the viewers are going to want to get that out, like, ASAP.
I assume that would be the case. Right. The number of code changes is very, very small, so I don't think that merging this will be a big deal. It's mostly just those avatar files. But unfortunately, if you don't get the code fixes, you can end up with some pretty bizarre looking avatars that have.
Well, consider that if we were to pick that up,
poking out of them.
Assume that by the time you guys are ready to release that, that we've still not finished merging Project Interesting, Sunshine, and all those other things. Would we be able to take just that little bit of mesh deformer code and put it into, say, our 4.5.1 release and send it as a hotfix kind of thing?
That's a good question, and I don't really have a prediction with respect to that. The build I have now, not the one that's out, but the build I have now is merged all the way up to the GPU table fixes. So, whether or not, and the one that's out was the release before that is based on 3.6.10. So whether or not there's something that happened to get changed, up to that point that is actually critically important is something I actually have no way to answer because we never attempted to test it otherwise.
Okay.
Is there a source code repository for this?
Yes.
There is.
Yes. oz_linden/storm1985.
Okay, thank you.
The present state of that repo might not exactly match the shipping thing because I've been committing things, but I forget how much I've actually pushed out to Bitbucket. I believe I pushed out the update to 3.6.11, but that is not in it's got the GPU, the repo has the GPU table updates, but the shipping project viewer does not yet.
I just want to take a peek at what's changed in the handling of the skeleton inside the code and what changes are required.
Right there. I think it's in LLVO avatar. There was something.
Okay.
I think that's where the main fix was. It was fixes by that Dave P did. But fitted mesh is coming along nicely, and we're looking forward to that. And the rest of the usual projects are still out there. Who have we got here today? Monty, you're here. Where are we with HTTP, Monty? Oh, Monty doesn't have a voice dot.
Nope, having trouble getting voice going. Not the full Monty.
I guess Nix can tell us about how far Sunshine is going on.
Gladly. Sunshine is going really well, actually. We're trying to clean up the last few remaining bugs that we know about. And we're hoping to get it into the QA process and get a project viewer out sometime soon-ish. We'll see if we make the get one out before. Window. Yeah, we'll see if we can hit that or not. If not, look for it early January. But we are also wanting to start doing more load testing for the new inventory service, AIS v3. So wanted to get an update from you guys on where you're at with integration with the Sunshine repository and what time frames you guys have before you think you'd be ready to help with a Pylon test.
Tank?
So for Firestorm, we have everything merged in. The only thing that we have planned on doing is re-adding the legacy bacon for OpenSim. But we're going to not just push it back in like it was before you took it out. We're going to look into maybe pulling those off into separate files so that way it doesn't interfere with merging as you make code changes later on in the next years or whatever.
Just quickly, sorry, just for the other third-party viewers, Nikki is working on that, I believe, and she'll be making that public for the other viewers to benefit from. Next, that would mean that we have a build in our beta testing group right now, which we could, in theory, use for Pylon.
Excellent. That's great to hear. Any other third-party viewers interested in hopping on that as well?
No, Kutula has it merged in.
In Singularity, we haven't started on it yet, so I don't think from our side there'll be anything soon. Do you know when these inventory services will be put into production? It's usually done ahead of when Viewer is the project Viewer is released.
I don't have an exact time frame for that, but we are trying to move forward on that, which is one of the reasons why we want to do the Pylon test and make sure that it can hold up under decent load. We have automated tests, but Pylon tests tend to bring out other failure cases. So I don't have an exact time frame for that, but hopefully in the not too distant future, we'd roll it out into production probably pretty quietly at first because it wouldn't be exposed to any regions. And then slowly do a rollout to turn it on across the grid. And yeah, as Tank said, anyone is welcome to test against it on Aditi right now.
So maybe sometime in December, we can try to get a real Pylon test organized.
Any other questions for Sunshine?
Doesn't look like Monty made it back, so...
He just came back.
Oh, okay. And did he succeed in coming back with voice? I was just scanning my list here.
He did.
Yeah, there he is. Monty, do you have an HTTP update for us?
Yes. I do. I just upgraded my development Mac to 10.7. It's a low-end machine, and I am having fun getting things stable again. HTTP. It is currently still in QA. There have been no bugs found so far, though we are finding quite a few in Mesh in general, and those are getting filed right and left. The test plan is going to take some more time to execute. The lead QA guy is currently predicting December 3rd before he's finished, and that can and it can become a project viewer and move onward. But the thing is there. It looks good. All the numbers that come out of the performance aspects of the tests are equal or better than past history. And, yeah, generally looking good. It's just going to take some while to get through there. That's it on HTTP. Phase 4, which is the pipelining piece, is moving forward. It we started going through libraries and discovered many things. I don't know if Oz has been talking about it. But I actually am interested in getting feedback from all the TPV developers as to the library mess we have. I've gone and tracked, manually traced through every dependency and all the package mismatches and the unnecessary libraries we are supplying, for example, Linux. And if anyone has some good arguments for not cleaning this up and not starting to remove some unnecessary pieces like glib libraries in the packaging, I'd like to hear about it because I would really like to call a few things out of there.
Well, there, it's a real mess. And the last time I did this recompile was discovering that, for example, on Windows, one version of the boost library is linked to the viewer, and another version is linked with Collada library. So it's a big mess in there.
Yep, that's true. I'm typically finding three versions of boost in any particular release, anywhere from 2 to 4 versions of zlib. Et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, that's a mess. And we are packaging an enormous number of unnecessary libraries, apparently, on Linux. I know, no one cares. But
you are also packaging some that you are also not packaging some that should be packaged. Because there was an issue with, again, with Boost being being linked dynamically to the system ICU. Internationalization library, and that causes trouble because ICU is not it's a C++ library, and it's, you know, if you dynamically load that across different versions, it causes trouble.
Yeah, we've actually been working our way through documenting a wide range of those problems, although as usual Linux gets a little less attention than others. We will. There is a concerted lobbying effort going on to try to get a project organized to get all that cleaned up. So we'll see whether that happens after the new year or not. It probably won't happen in a large way before then.
I'm actually interested in the ICU. On which platform were you seeing dynamic linkage? I specifically did go and follow that one through. It seemed to be static everywhere.
The last one I tried was dynamically linked on Linux.
Ah,
okay. So you need to install a system ICU, but you know that's on Linux doesn't really work across widely different versions. So you should check that its ICU is linked statically into Boost on Linux.
Another thing I was doing was actually enabling for the first time the unit test of each of the libraries. And I actually found out that Boost was failing on Linux in file system because of code convert issues, which is a UCS2 to UTF-8 failure. And that kind of smells like ICU, maybe. I'll take a look at that.
Yeah, but Boost is a mess in general because it's you have some local modifications like renaming coroutines into D coroutines and stuff like that, which makes it difficult to deal with. I have no idea what that rename was all about when it was done.
Neither do I. The documentation and comments that go along with it are pretty miserable. And actually, that's yet another thing I've been tasked with doing as I got through this. Each of the libraries that I've been touching is actually getting a README that describes why it's getting modified in some fashion and so on. But if anyone wants to share their wisdom with me, having gone through the libraries or been exposed to something, just email your rants to me, Monty@. I would love to hear them, as I will be touching quite a few things in the next few weeks. And if Oz is lucky, he'll get this project going as well.
I know that the getting Boost and Collada and all that circular dependency things to build correctly, it's a pure hell.
Yeah, I found that. And Collada actually has its own copy of libz and libxml2 and a few other things for another god unknown reason. Yep, agreed. But send me your rants. Email and read your rants. Maybe I can make it'll help me get a coherent fixed story going on these things as we move forward.
Monty has already produced an astonishing document that you know would horrify any sensible programmer who read it. So he's been building up good ammunition for us.
I went through that with building Windows 64-bit libraries, and I've been through those parts recently, so I can relate to the experience.
Right. Well, good. So we sort of segued away from HTTP there, but there is progress being made. And I haven't heard any update lately from Baker on group bans, except that he's distressed to discover that he's become the go-to expert on people API issues. So,
last I've heard, group bans is one of my projects. Last I've heard is, testing's coming along, just working through the issues, nothing major.
Yeah. Good. Thanks. So we should have code for that appearing at some point.
Next week, maybe?
Yeah.
And make a great Christmas present.
Yeah, there we go. Hey, come on. I got an early one out with fitted mesh, so.
I really appreciate that you guys got that out with, very minimal code. That's awesome.
Well, that was a significant part of the motivation for that alternative, of course.
Yeah, that was a big reason why we did that approach, that solution.
So, which I guess gets us through the stuff that's on the agenda. I do have one sort of surprise. Yes. Just the sort of thing that happens in Second Life meetings that doesn't happen in other sorts of meetings. I do have one other special guest who has a pitch to make here. This is slightly off topic, more an open source issue than a third party viewer issue, but of course they overlap. We have a rep here from Leap Motion.
Oh, cool.
You want to take it away? You need to make sure your mic is live. There's a little microphone button you got to press. I think by default it's at the bottom of the screen, or it's also there's a microphone button in the top left of your. All right, who's messing with the screens?
I didn't do it.
I haven't even enabled it.
Well, so I can, well, Alexa, could you see if you can coach John Alt to get voice working?
Will do.
And I will, while Alexa is helping me there, I will just give you the very briefest form. Leap Motion is interested in getting the Leap Motion controller well integrated into the Second Life viewer, and of course, ultimately into the third party viewers as well. So they have been very gracious and provided us with some test hardware, and that is controllers to play with, and they're prepared to provide consulting and help for people that want to do it. Well, Simon did a very crude prototype. We're going to shoot for something a little bit more smoothly integrated.
That was more of a proof of concept, wasn't it?
Yeah, exactly. So they'd like to work with somebody. We don't have anybody to put on the project right now. We've got a lot of stuff on our plate at the moment, and there's more you don't know about. So, we're pretty busy, but, we want to try to support this in whatever way we can. So, put the word out among developers, you know, that, we're looking for somebody to do the work on this and get it contributed and integrated and into the code. And you have an opportunity to be, famous and celebrated.
I'm going to have them relog. It's faster than going through the tutorial.
I hate it when that happens. USB.
Thank you, Alexa.
No problem.
Yeah, so they're sending me one, so I'll be able to test whatever anybody does.
I think on our team, probably the best dev I would put on that would be Cinder. She's got experience already with Control-Alt Studios. But like she said, she did apply for one, didn't get one. And obviously we can't develop that one.
That's a problem we can solve. I can get a few of these things and get them into the right people's hands, as long as we're going to get some attention. Whether or not what Simon already did is going to contain any useful bits is not a question I actually have any idea of the answer to. But obviously, if it is, that we've got that. Other topics?
I see John is back.
John, are you... You got voice working again? Let's see if...
He does have a voice dot.
Yeah, he has a voice dot. Yeah, these things happen.
The mic source may be sent wrong.
Just as an aside here, I've been noticing problems with the updated voice files myself and through not the vast majority of our users, but a significant number.
Actually, I just added an IM from a user having troubles with. So Oz, the new voice files apparently for, you know, a small percentage, maybe 10%, are having stuttering issues.
Okay.
The only solution we've had is to send them back to 4.4.2, which was pre that update.
No, it was pre that update, because it was the Vox 2.3 or something like that.
Anyway, it's significant enough that if we push out, you know, a full-on release with the current problems, we're going to be inundated with people with voice problems.
I don't know whether we've seen any similar increase in problem reports there or not.
I'll file a JIRA on it. I tested on the latest stable LL release, and I get the same issue. But it's a weird one. It affects some people, but not others.
Yeah, and if you file a bug, I'll take a look at it.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, and...
Thanks, Alexa.
I mean, we can... It's the sort of thing we're liable to... that sounds like the sort of thing we're liable to have to get Vivox involved in debugging.
Yeah, that's...
probably bad network paths or something.
Well, we may end up going back to old voice files for our next release, depending on time frame on when that can be fixed.
Right. I guess it would be helpful if you could try to find a way to quantify how frequently we're getting the problem.
Yeah, that it seems to be. It doesn't seem to be related to network so much. Myself and one of the other team members had experienced the stuttering or reverb. It's almost like a max headroom type effect. Somebody says, "I'm going now," and you hear, "I'm going now."
Stuttering?
And sometimes it's to the point where it's just totally unintelligible. Like, I can't teach classes on the 4.5.1.
Yeah, I agree with Hank. It does sound like some type of a buffering issue.
Is it the sender being on the newer voice that's the problem, or the receiver?
It doesn't seem to matter. If you're on the latest voice files, you get it regardless whether they're on 4.4.2 or on the 4.5.1.
Okay, I guess I didn't ask that in a way that was very clear. It is almost certainly significant for the purposes of debugging to determine whether it's the recipient being on the newer files that's the problem, or the sender being on the speaker being on the newer files that's the problem. It's almost certainly not both.
Okay, it's most likely the speaker in that case.
It would be good to try to, if you get a circumstance under which it's, you think it's reproducible, it would be good to try to actually do some experiments to try to pin that down. That would be really valuable. I used to do a lot of voice over IP stuff, so I need to know a little bit more about this than I would like to.
Okay, I can tell you this much. It's definitely on the sender's end, because when I'm teaching on the old voice files, people don't get the stuttering issue. If I'm teaching on the updated voice files, they do get it.
Ah, okay. Well, that's important. Have we correlated it to any particular platform? That is, does it appear as often on Macs as it does on Windows?
The world has some input there in text as well.
Tell you what, send me a Mac and a Linux box of Haas and I'll test for you.
Good to have goals.
What, you missed the facetiousness in that statement?
Yeah, Bluesy's on Mac, right?
Yeah. As for how many people on each are going to be affected, it's going to be tough to figure out.
Right, but okay, so people are hearing the problem, but if you were right, then it's the speaker who's important. So the thing to do would be to do...
Yeah, I'm wondering how much this issue will go away if everybody was on the new voice. I'm not saying that there aren't other issues with the new voice, but...
You mean it could be a backwards compatibility issue?
Yeah, that's what I'm wondering.
Yeah, it would be good to try to get that, do that experiment. Maybe, you know, it sounds like we'd have to kind of organize a group of people with the right combination of stuff and take turns speaking.
If you want my help, you know how to reach me.
Okay.
I'd be glad to help out with it.
Yeah.
I have a little bit of feedback on the 64-bit Windows release we made last week, if you are interested.
Yeah, by all means.
So about a week ago, we made a release, and a couple of interesting things have emerged that kind of surprised me. Was we had something like 20,000 downloads in the first couple of days, and the ratio of when people are given the equal opportunity to download one or the other, we had about 60% downloading 64-bit version and about 40% downloading 32-bit version. And the other significant bit is that it's the crash rate of the 60-bit version is remarkably lower, which points out that at least in Singularity we have a bit of problem with memory handling, and that 32-bit version cannot really cope with the memory demands we put on it. Especially, it looks like the people that have 2 GB of RAM in their machines, their experience using Singularity is not very good. They will crash if they go to a bit crowded place. So those are the two most important facts that have emerged in the last 7-8 days since we have this release.
Have you checked to make sure that, because I noticed your crash rate on 64-bit is like half of that on your 32, and that's like really big. And I'm just wondering if you guys might have had a crash reporting issues like we had and like Linen Lab had as well. And now
we use a very old, we didn't merge any of the code or changes in the crash reporting part for a long, long time. So there were no changes in that area.
I think I've probably said this before, but once the Google BrakePad code moves to the main to viewer release, it probably would be worthwhile for everybody to take a close look at how the marker file and crash detection code is done in that, because it's been significantly cleaned up and moved so that it covers much more of the execution. It turns out that prior to those changes, the marker file that is used to detect whether or not you had exited was actually created quite late in initialization. And similarly, the ones that are created to detect crashes around logout were being created and then destroyed very quickly, and there was an awful lot of code that wasn't inside the envelope that they define.
In Singularity, that code hasn't changed in a couple of years. So as a baseline, you can compare it freely with previous versions of Singularity. I'm not sure how comparable it is with other viewers at this point. But right. The crash rate delta from our previous version shows that 64-bit is much, much more stable.
Well, yeah, and that part actually isn't all that surprising. I mean, our stats show that even our 32-bit only builds are very substantially more stable on 64-bit OSs, and we're not even building for 64-bit.
Yes.
So the 64-bit versions of Windows appear to just be significantly better than the 32-bit versions.
And people tend to have more memory with 64-bit operating systems. And if they're running 32-bit, they may be having 2 right. gigabytes. So...
Yeah, and we do get access to more memory. But, I mean, we all have our theories. My theory is mostly that the people who are still running the 32-bit OSs include a larger percentage of people who never update anything, and you know, they've got old drivers and God knows what else.
But the download ratio was a bit surprising to me, that 60% of people downloaded the 64-bit version, actually, of the whole
That is surprising.
We had when we put out our 64-bit alpha, I had requested feedback from users, and generally when you request feedback from users, 90% of it is negative. So we know there's going to be placebo among some of that feedback. But we actually had no negative comments so far, and it's still coming in. But we've had no negative comments about 64-bit, other than, you know, I have this bug or I have that bug. But these are bugs that actually exist on both the 32 and the 64, but so they're not specific. So when you eliminate those, there's not been one negative comment about our 64-bit. So as far as, obviously there's placebo, but as far as user perception is concerned, 64-bit is a huge win as far as the user is concerned.
Yeah. Yeah, that's terrific. So it will be very interesting to see what happens when that's out to a population that's not self-selected.
Yeah, that's my other thing. Is I imagine those same people who downloaded the 64-bit probably weren't crashing like crazy anyhow. Also, assuming it's done properly, there's nothing to perceive in the change.
The offered it as an equal download, so you go to download page and you can pick any, 64-bit, 32-bit as you please. So I don't think there was much bias or self-selection there, And we have a vast number of people using it now, so If there was something catastrophic about it, we would hear by now.
Yeah. No, what I meant by self-selected is, you know, especially in the Firestorm beta program,
it's the more advanced people.
There are people who decided that they're willing to run test viewers. We have very consistently seen that we get very significantly lower crash rates on project viewers and betas back when we were doing the beta program than we got on the very same software, identical software, released to the general user population. The crash rate always went up by quite a bit. And in fact, one of the things that we've been experimenting with quite a lot now that we have the release candidate system, since we can decide how many people are going to, how large a cohort is going to be before we, at any given time, we can just keep adding people to it. One of the things that we've been doing is trying to figure out how big a cohort do we need to have for the crash rate and other stats not to change after we promote it to the default release. And it turns out that the numbers are really big.
We have seen the same thing, that people on our alpha channel typically have better machine and are more adventurous, but which is why I thought it would be interesting to give these numbers now that we have it in a general release. So there is no such bias of, you know, people who are on the cutting edge and always wanting to get the latest and the greatest.
Right. Yeah, I understand.
Any news on Havoc 64?
No.
And the other thing was, any news on, again, I'm going to keep nagging you, we would really like and would really benefit from OS-specific crash rates.
Yes, I have been harassing our report generation people about that very thing. And fortunately, I'm not even alone in harassing them for that. So, I don't know. I will continue passing on your nagging.
And just because that, as you know, that would be, you know, a huge benefit. Because, you know, it's quite possible that most
believe
of our
me, we want it as
Mac,
badly as you do.
You know.
Yeah. We absolutely want it as badly as you do. So, I will try again on that.
Jessica, do you know how many users do you have on a Mac version?
Not accurately. We can look at our downloads, but that's a really, you know, inaccurate number because. Just because they've downloaded it doesn't mean they've installed it. It also doesn't mean that they may have uninstalled it and gone back to an older version. So really, we have no way to track that. You know, I suppose we could put the infrastructure in and track it through crash reporting, but then we're only tracking those who crash. No, we don't really have an accurate way of tracking that. That's why I'm hoping, you know, we can get that from LinenLab.
Right. I've been bugging them for those stats for our viewers, and every time I bug them for those stats for our viewers, I make sure that I put in a note that says, oh, and I need to be able to do the exact same thing for an arbitrary third-party viewer channel.
Cool.
So if I get one, I'll probably get the other. But
the only way we could tell is also by the downloads. And our downloads show that 90% is Windows, and for Singularity, which is quite popular on Linux, we have a probably higher number than the rest, but we get about 6% Mac and 4% Linux in our downloads.
We have Google Analytics on our login page, and through that we can use Google Analytics to roughly determine what percentage are Mac, Windows, Linux, who are on 32-bit, 64-bit Windows, you know, that kind of thing. But again, that's also not accurate because...
I can actually get those stats for anything that's using our viewer version manager because we know the platforms that are requesting updates.
Right. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink.
But we don't collect the stats from that on platforms that we don't have configured. So
that's a good plug.
There you go. I figured out a way to work that in.
Very good.
Okay. So other new topics. Thank you for the info on 64-bit, Latif. We're watching you guys and your experiments with that, and your experiences with that very, very closely. It is not going unnoticed. And we appreciate
you going out there and getting the arrows to your backs on this. You can assume that most Singularity users on the newest version are on the 64-bit.
Yeah, I think that the reality is, even though it's perhaps a bit early to say, I think it's very unlikely to change. 64-bit is like the way to go, you know, moving forward for everybody.
Yeah, the big downside for us is that it's, you know, another whole platform to test.
Yeah, same with us. So,
but
yeah, and stuff like libraries are not always available.
The improved crash rates will become irresistible, I think. So we're getting close to the end of our hour. What have we? Is there anything more?
I have nothing to add. I just wanted to ask Latif, are you guys working on a Linux, or do you already have the Linux 64 out?
We had a Linux 64 bit from the beginning.
So for a while, okay. Oh, we've just had. I can't get Tech Wolf. His availability is like impossible now. Otherwise, I have nothing to add.
Okay, I guess we're done. Thank you all very much. And folks that are interested in the Leap Motion project, contact me and or there was an email address back here in chat somewhere.
It was doe@leapmotion.com.
Yeah, doe@leapmotion.com.
Cinder, can you send that email? Or do you want me to send it? Oh, good. You're on top of it. All right. Thanks for the meeting, guys, and have a good weekend. I am off.
Mug you later.
Thanks, Jess.
And Alexa, do you just want me to add to that existing Jira?
Yes, please. That would be great.
Okay, okay. I'll get on that this afternoon. Or while this
great,
evening.
Thank you.
And poof.